This is Duke University.
I'm delighted to call Robin Wiegman now to introduce our first speaker, Annamarie Jagos.
I should say these name tags are for our filming, not because we demand to have our name in front of us to speak. Okay, so for the website. Critical theory has taught us to avoid binary categories, but sometimes there's good reason to refuse the demand for theoretical correctness. So let's just say today that there are two kinds of academics: those who work hard and those who work so hard they make the rest of us look like we're on vacation. Annamarie Jagos, professor and head of the School of Letters, Arts, and Media at the University of Sydney, co-editor of GLQ, the flagship journal in sexuality studies, author of three important monographs, two of which I would call Lesbian Queer Theory. She may not agree with me, but I'd just like to say that. Lesbian Queer Theory. Award-winning novelist and short story writer, international star in queer and feminist studies, and also, less readable from her CV, but otherwise known to those who have worked with her, a sane, engaging, completely committed intellectual, in love with the work she does, and eager to learn from the work that engages others. She seems to write academic books and novels at the same time, with Lesbian Utopics, a monograph, and In Translation, a novel appearing in the same year, followed by her well-known Introduction to Queer Theory, and shortly thereafter, Lulu, a Romance, all before her publications this century, In Consequence, Lesbian Representation and the Logic of Sexual Sequence, and the novel Slow Water, which appeared in back-to-back years. She will speak today from her current book project, Orgasmology, which wonders about the strange queer theoretical absence of a studied interest in sex, that category that is routinely taken to define the field through the now famous distinction, as Janet Halley puts it, between sex one, meaning sexual difference, and sex two, sex itself, the practice, the act. How has queer theory been so engaged by the idea of sex, but so inattentive to the methodological project of generating a queer theoretical archive on the very sex that it claims for itself? Jagos begins to answer this question, not by taking up the referenced but rarely explicated terrain of that thing called queer sex, but by shifting the terms of the inquiry altogether toward orgasm, that 20th century invention that seems utterly complicit with masculinist and heterosexist organizations of embodied desire. By emphasizing the historical and by reading against the grain of orgasm's easy dismissal, Jagos marshals a case for the significance of orgasm to the development of a queer theoretic. The argument is complex, as you will hear shortly, but the critical yield is enormous. For in following the career of an entity that resists representation, even as it is repetitively, indeed compulsively, analyzed, promoted, commodified, celebrated, and decried, Jagos engages with the political belief that sustains contemporary queer theory, that normativity is something we already know. At first glance, Orgasmology builds most distinctly on Jagos' earlier work by furthering her long-standing engagement with queer theory. But it also takes up a conversation across her books about representation, or more precisely, about the unrepresentable. I confess that I have always taught queer theory an introduction by paying attention to the cover's performative absence, in part because I thought my students needed to contemplate the problem of representing a field dedicated to undermining well-worn formulas for critical and political representation. So we've always talked about the space of absence of the cover, right? But this week, in doing a little more research, I learned that I have not been teaching the book that Jagos created. Rather, I was teaching its censored American version. This is the first PowerPoint I've ever made. I had to learn technology for you. It's a little, can you see the Noti character very well there? And Ken, you kind of, not so well. So, lights, will that help? Better. There you go. Okay. There's always a story, she wrote to me after my inquiry. All the time I was writing queer theory, I had an eye out for my cover. I wanted an image which was undeniably about sex, yet not the kind of sex that could be easily recuperated by identity-based constituencies. An image which aligned itself with the narrative of lesbian and gay histories, yet was not bound to them. An image which made itself available to currently unimaginable identificatory projections. In short, she says, I had no idea what I was looking for, yet I knew at once when I saw this image that I had my cover. She went on to say, when it comes to my own work and against popular wisdom, I always judge a book by its cover. When NYU picked up the book, apparently, and now I'm quoting from her, there was considerable bafflement in their office as to how to read the image. We're not sure of the little gnome, wrote the New York editor to my Melbourne editor. And they weren't much convinced by my lengthy reply that Noti is a prominent character in British children's fiction or literature. At the time, she says, I was exacerbated with what looked like a typically North American refusal to accept the relevance of any cultural paradigm that did not take the USA as its template for culture. I mean, what amazes me is it's okay to show Ken like this. Anyway, you know. Since receiving her email earlier this week, I've been thinking about her insistence on a book's materiality and wondering with delight what she will want as a cover for orgasmology. She may not yet know, or she may not be keen on telling us. No matter, today I'm happy to say I'm all ears. Please welcome Annamarie Jagos.
Thanks very much, Robin, for that generous introduction. And thanks, Ranjana, for inviting me in the first place, an invitation I was very happy to receive. Robin, I suspect, had put her up to it and deserves double thanks on that account. And my thanks, too, to Lillian. Is the mic picking me up? And thanks to Lillian, too, for all the countless emails back and forth explaining various small but important things that have made today go so well. I sort of feel like I need to confess at the start that I'm slightly deranged by jet lag. I arrived this morning actually at 2 a.m. From Sydney, I think after a sort of 26-hour travel. But hence I'm strangely reassured by Ranjana's opening comments that have reminded me that feminist anxiety can actually ravage audiences more severely than its presenters. Seems to me like a fair arrangement, given how many of you there are and how lonely it might seem back here. And Robin has already confessed to me that she woke up this morning unaccountably nervous, which seemed like she was going to do my nerves for me, which was sweet, although now I understand it was really because it was her first PowerPoint. as Robin's indicated, I'm going to be talking from a manuscript in progress called Orgasmology. Happy to talk about the cover, although perhaps not from the podium when Ken is in the audience, my publisher. This section is really comes from the introduction, so it's fairly overviewish in its kind of approach, and I think hence hopefully will be more accessible than some other aspects of the project perhaps. And I won't go into too much detail now, kind of scene setting what the big project is, partly because it's been done so nicely for me already by Robin, but obviously in question time or feedback time we can talk about that some more as necessary. So, orgasmology. What does queer theory teach us about orgasm? The global roaming system that has been the nearest thing to a methodology that queer theory has espoused to date, the way in which its attraction to the abject, the subaltern, the eccentric, and the minoritarian deems no subject so outre to be altogether out of bounds, might suggest that orgasm, with its affinities for sex and those relations, both personal and impersonal, to which sex gives rise, would fall easily and squarely inside a queer theoretical purview. And yet queer theory, by which I mean those post-humanist and anti-identitarian critical approaches that are energised by thinking against the practices, temporalities and modes of being through which sexuality has been normatively thought, has had next to nothing to say of orgasm. Next to nothing, rather than plain nothing, since reading between the lines, it's possible to detect a whiff of the queer theoretical dismissal of orgasm, so subtextual and sotto voce I hesitate to call it a strand, in which orgasm gets aligned with the normal against which the queer defines itself. It's necessarily difficult to give a citational sense of what I'm describing, but a genealogical account of the dismissal of orgasm as inadequately queer might begin with the work of two prominent members of queer theory's tag wrestling team, Michel Foucault and Gilles Deleuze, both of whom associate orgasm with the normalising forces their critical projects differently counter. Refusing the idea that sex speaks in the tongue of liberation, Foucault famously argues that sex remains a crucial point of purchase for modern power, less because it is prohibited, denied, and censored, than because it's an important node in the strategic expansion and multiplication of the networks of power that characterise modern liberal societies. Foucault's thinking is, of course, much more centrally organised around the notion of sexuality than orgasm per se. Yet on those few occasions when he does consider orgasm specifically, he identifies it as an erotic phenomenon particularly bound to the regulatory and normalising aspects of modern sexuality. Arguing against a liberationist tradition that privileges sex as a resource for getting out from under the repressive operations of power, and therefore as a potential zone of freedom, Foucault makes it clear that orgasm must not be misrecognised as the truthful confession of bodily pleasures. Rather, he insists that orgasm be seen instead as yet another of the gestures or techniques by which power battens down on the body and through a strategic dissemination of its capacities and proclivities, disciplines pleasure's unchoreographed potential into the normalising operation of desire. He writes, "The most important elements of an erotic art linked to our knowledge about sexuality are not to be sought in the ideal promised to us by medicine of a healthy sexuality, nor in the humanist dream of a complete and flourishing sexuality, and certainly not in the lyricism of orgasm and the good feelings of bioenergy. These are but aspects of its normalising utilisation." Foucault goes so far as to say that the processes of self-invention that he's advocating through the production of new pleasures at the level of the body depend in part on a renunciation of orgasm as the acme of sexual experience. After all, he writes, "The point is to detach oneself from this virile form of obligatory pleasure, namely orgasm." In direct refutation of Marxist and psychoanalytic traditions of liberationist thought, Foucault specifically aligns orgasm with normalising disciplinary power, enigmatically suggesting that effective resistance to such power depends on the strategic occupancy of non-orgasmic pleasures. Often associated with his contemporary Foucault on the basis of their Nietzschean commitment to genealogical inquiry and their aversion to the psychoanalytic paradigms that dominated leftist thinking on social transformation, Deleuze, with Félix Guattari, also works to enunciate an alternate economy, a different rhizomatic conceptualisation of desire that by being open to the energies and mutating potentialities of things, deterritorialises structures of Western thought. Deleuze and Foucault famously differ on their definitions of desire and pleasure. And while the divergences between their larger critical projects shouldn't be underestimated, it's notable that their respective framings of pleasure and desire coincide in figuring orgasm in the service of the forces of social control. Where Foucault understands desire as normative, something associated with regulation and medical taxonomization, for Deleuze it is a productive, positive, and social force that exceeds the organism and eludes systems of subjectification. Where Foucault understands pleasure as experimental and resolutely non-disciplinary, Deleuze refers instead to the external rule of pleasure, representing it as an impediment to desire's improvisational capacity to form connections and generate intensities. Foucault advocates pleasure for its potential to shatter the psychic structures that bind bodies to sexual identities, while Deleuze promotes desire for much the same reason, dismissing pleasure as, and I'm quoting, the only means for a person or a subject to find itself again in a process that surpasses it. Although Deleuze and Foucault argue that sex is only one instantiation of desire or pleasure, they are nevertheless in emphatic agreement that orgasm exemplifies the term each disparages and is therefore, by being structured in dominance, at odds with the progressive projects of social transformation that each one differently proposes. In A Thousand Plateaus, Deleuze develops with Guattari the notion of the plateau to express a form ungoverned by standard organisational principles such as hierarchy, sequence and totalisation. Borrowing the notion of the plateau from Gregory Bateson's mid-20th century anthropological studies of Balinese culture, Deleuze and Guattari use it to describe unalloyed intensities, which they say are constituted in such a way that they do not allow themselves to be interrupted any more than they allow themselves to build towards a climax. Once again, excuse me, as for Foucault, orgasm is the handy instantiation of a libidinal economy that must be abandoned. Insensitive to the logics of the plateau, and a prime example of the way pleasure reroutes desire as discharge, orgasm is singled out by Deleuze and Guattari as, in their words, a mere fact, a rather deplorable one, in relation to desire in pursuit of its principle. So in linking orgasm to the normalising strategies of modern power, in characterising it as an effect of the regulation and rigidification of sexuality, Foucault and Deleuze explicitly exclude it from any repertoire of progressive practices. On account of its definitional centrality to everyday understandings of sex, its routinisation and reification of genitally focused sensation, and its ready availability to the psychologising and medicalising discourses of normalisation, orgasm is knitted up with a disciplinary system that has, as Leo Bassani puts it, until now taught us what sex is, and consequently is the very is the very opposite of pleasure in the Foucauldian sense. On account of its habituated teleological character, its allegiance to discharge rather than intensification, and its molar organisation, orgasm is always a re-territorialisation of the subject disarranged by desire, and consequently is the very epitome of pleasure in the Deleuzian sense. Although nowhere is significant in terms of shaping queer theoretical formations, no doubt in large part because of its deeply ambivalent relation to feminism, it's also worth keeping in mind here the work of Jean Baudrillard, and in particular his spirited rejection of orgasm, a polemic that organises itself primarily around the enigmatic promise of seduction, taking as its most charged actor the anorgasmic woman. Baudrillard figures orgasm as seduction's other, as everything seduction is not. He writes, "The law of seduction takes the form of an uninterrupted ritual exchange where seducer and seduced constantly raise the stakes in a game that never ends. Sex, on the other hand, has a quick, banal end. the orgasm, the immediate form of desire's realisation. Against orgasm's closural economies, Baudrillard spruiks instead the open-ended and contingent pleasures of sex not scripted by orgasm. He writes, "Sexual pleasure too is reversible. In the absence or denial of the orgasm, superior intensity is possible. It's here where the end of sex becomes aleatory again that something arises that can be called seduction." On the one hand, seduction, with its endless, supple allegiances to the instability of play. On the other, the dull banality of orgasm, with its predictable arrest of desire. It's because the presumed value of orgasm is drawn from an intrinsically masculine economy that the orgasm about which Baudrillard has the most to say, the same one that for very different reasons most occupies our post-sexological culture, is female orgasm. But where such post-sexological discourses speak to the value of female orgasm, disseminate information and advice about how best to secure one, and extol the importance, even the necessity, of women taking their sexual pleasure in this form, Baudrillard suggests rather that women defer or even reject orgasm, going so far as to argue that the recent call for women's access to orgasmic pleasure, most commonly heard in the progressive cadences of feminism or sexual liberation, is designed to organise the feminine as a sex, to fix it in a structure of binary difference, and to have women identify with the category of their domination. He writes, "It's because femininity secretly prevails that it must be recycled and normalised in sexual liberation in particular, and in the orgasm. Once again, orgasm is the figure through which it's demonstrated that liberation doesn't mark a break from, but is continuous with strategies of domination, whose most effective technique is not coercion, but normalisation." This idea of orgasm as the site or sign of normative acquiescence to broad structures of social control, so marked in influential works of high theory, also secures a general currency in progressive critical thought, as can be seen, for example, in Stephen Heath's The Sexual Fix. For Heath, the fix we're in as modern sexual subjects is that we're required to recognise ourselves in relation to a narrowly defined understanding of sexuality, the terms of which then come to define full human potential, autonomy, and even liberation. From the sexological medicalisation of sex and its production via the invention of perversions of sexual normativity, through the psychoanalytic revelation of the sexual as the underbelly of conscious life and the key to our interiorised subjectivities, to the popular therapeutic conflation of sexual function with pleasure or fulfilment or freedom, Heath traces the ways in which we are interpolated as modern sexual citizens, defining this as the sexual fix. While the sexual fix can be identified across a range of discourses and asserts its influence via various strategies, one singular thing emerges as its exemplary expression. I'm guessing you're going to know what this is. As Heath writes, orgasm, in short, is the key manoeuvre in the sexual fix. For Heath, the discursive centrality of orgasms for discussions of sexuality testifies to the way in which it becomes the standard unit of measurement for sexuality, producing as a consequence the normative sexual subject. He writes, "The sexual revolution has produced and been caught up in a whole discourse of orgasm, a whole elaboration and representation, a standard of sexual life." Refusing the frequent connection between orgasm and the cultural project of sexual liberation, which claims orgasm as evidence of the emancipated sexual subject, Heath argues instead that such liberatory discourses obscure the degree to which orgasm functions as a regulatory measure that establishes normative and standardised definitions of sexual identity and experience. It follows then that the cultural expression of sexuality is for Heath entirely consistent with regimes of liberal power. Modern sexual subjects are compelled to experience their freedom as sexual self-expression, where that self-expression is always already in the service of the usual suspects of progressive critique: the heteronormative sex-gender system, strictly privatised and domesticated understandings of autonomy and freedom, commodification, and the free circulation of capital. Across a wide range of queer and more generally leftist critical projects, then, orgasm gets figured in the register of normativity, associated with regulation and control, with standardisation and the status quo. Orgasm is always in the service of systems of social oppression. This theoretical aversion for orgasm is worth questioning, however, given that orgasm is, as I'll suggest, an irregular and unpredictable formation that might more readily be understood to assist critical approaches that revel in rather than work to domesticate the incoherence that's designated by sex. Moreover, although the official queer disidentification with orgasm might make it seem perverse or just plain unproductive, I start here with queer theory in order to mark or remember the beginnings of my coming to think about orgasm as a scholarly object. After all, it was queer theoretical protocols or tendencies that substantialised orgasm for me as a node of critical attention in the first place, and queer theoretical impulses too, that made me persist in thinking with and through orgasm, even when it seemed that orgasm was constituted by queer theory as its bad object. X marks the spot. What does queer theory teach us about X is, of course, Lauren Berlant and Michael Warner's question. The title of one of their co-written essays, the form of which my opening sentence borrowed, "What does queer theory teach us about orgasm?" and to which my spot-marking X now slantingly returns. Mindful of the ways in which questions about the political efficacy of queer theoretical approaches are often enough bent on restoring the gay affirmative paradigms that queer critiques, Berlant and Warner nevertheless argue that questions about what queer theory can add to our understanding or knowledge also arise from circumstances of political urgency. Recalling that they have each been asked at different moments how queer theory might assist in thinking differently about a range of stuff, 12-step programs, the power of new markets, spirituality, for example, Berlant and Warner strip those inquiries back to a basic collective form uninflected by any particular investment in this or that knowledge project. What does queer theory teach us about X? Despite the convention by which X represents any unknown quantity or unnamed person, Berlant and Warner's X is not, I think, a placeholder, an empty term whose vacuity registers beyond itself an immense constellation of other objects, practices, and traditions that might, by being inserted in its place, enjoy the attentions of queer theory's critical flexibility. They know that queer theory is not a coherent system. It's not an analytic blueprint, nor a set of agreed practices and protocols through which any manner of matter can be reliably processed. Rather, in Berlant and Warner's question, X holds open the question of queer theory's political usefulness, holds it open by framing it as a question that can't be answered in this iteration. The final X, insisting on the form and the force of the question while withholding its specific content. The value of this question for Berlant and Warner is, I think, less the epistemological yield it promises in terms of an answer than the performative vigour that attaches to its interrogatory form, what it's being asked makes happen. They write, "As difficult as it would be to spell out programmatic content for an answer, this simple question still has the power to wrench frames." To ask what queer theory teaches us about orgasm, then, is not to sit back in expectation of an answer, so much as to offer up, by way of a provocation, the idea that queer theory and orgasm might be co-relevant, might usefully extend each other's expected reach. It's to take up a simple question without repudiating it as the dumb question for which such simple questions are often mistaken. It's to risk seeming naive, even backward, about queer scholarly knowledges or codes of critical inquiry. It's to seem not to know, for example, that orgasm's high cultural valuation is dependent on the extent to which it's domesticated as the basis for sexual encounters, whose value derives from the fact that they define and sustain relationships deemed socially responsible, ideally marital, minimally stable and monogamous, or that the long-standing but increasingly implausible connection between orgasm and political transformation depends on a liberationist understanding of power that queer theory foundationally refutes. Yet sticking with queer theory's pro-sex, anti-normative energies promises to open up a different set of terms, a different range of critical preoccupations for thinking about orgasm. Similarly, sticking with orgasm promises to disrupt the consolidation of what can sometimes feel like queer theoretical complacencies around what objects or events deserve critical attention, around which types of sexual actors or sexual practice most counter normative values and institutions, around what selfhood, community, ethics, and politics look and feel like. Initially, I gravitated to orgasm as a way of thinking about sex, of bringing out the sex in sexuality studies. Despite the increasing amount of humanities scholarship across the 1990s on sexuality, on homophobia, on sexual representation, on histories of sexuality, on sexual commodification, about sex itself, it seemed there was relatively little to say. Against the frequently and strategically made lesbian and gay claims that homosexuality was about much more than sex, in some articulations even that being gay was not about sex, queer theory seemed to me more willing to pay attention to sex, to think about it not as incidental or private, but as a site of intense engagement with social and psychic worlds, and to lay critical claim to the pleasures of sex alongside its negative effects. If it sometimes feels difficult within queer scholarly protocols to secure the recognisability of orgasm as a proper scholarly object, then that in itself promises much in terms of orgasm's availability as a point of critical leverage from which to re-articulate, both to prise apart and to pull into new configurations, what we know about sexuality, the stories we tell ourselves about sex. Several years into this project, I was already well versed in the effect the disclosure of my research topic reliably produced in contexts as various as an appearance before a university research funding committee, a conversation with immigration authorities at Heathrow, and an interview on breakfast television. An unpredictable combination of incredulity and jollity, the precise mix of which could be tweaked up or down to indicate approval or hostility, excitement or dismissal, recognition or exclusion. Not since the late 1980s, when I worked to convince my graduate studies director of the legitimacy of a lesbian dissertation topic, have I experienced research as such a volatile exercise in information management. Even so, I was unprepared for the media storm that broke when in 2006, as part of a three-person research team, I was awarded a national research grant for a sexuality studies project that included a module on orgasm. Initially, the story was about perceived conflicts of interest at work in the national funding system. But from the beginning, there was also prominent attention paid to the outlandishness of funding research on orgasm. And it was this angle that kept the story alive across three fevered weeks, drawing a range of responses from journalists and media commentators, talkback radio audiences, academics, members of parliament, and even the Prime Minister. Although I hadn't anticipated the levels of public indignation over my project's funding, nor the length of time across which it would be sustained and even raised a notch or two, the various rhetorical twists given the narrative over the next few weeks were at least familiar enough to me from those skirmishes widely known as the culture wars to arrive in an impersonal register. It was all there, the gross abuse of public funds, still psychically attached to their imaginary source, as can be seen in their being frequently described as the intimately singular taxpayer's dollar. The exposure of the queer feminist agenda and its successful infiltration of the highest levels of public culture. The deterioration of cultural life such that subjects that should remain behind the quarantine of domestic privacy take centre stage. And the intellectual bankruptcy of academic work that even the most untrained member of the public can see through in a second. While I couldn't help but note the matter-of-fact aggression with which I was routinely identified as a lesbian in media contexts where that classification served automatically to discredit me, I thought I detected a different kind of feeling vibrating outward from orgasm, a word that went into gratifyingly high media use across this period. I don't think I've ever seen orgasm in so many, you know, New Zealand national newspaper headings. And at this stage in the project, I could sort of read the word orgasm, sort of like almost like recognising your own name. You know, if I saw organism or something somewhere, I would always be thinking, oh, you know, I've got to pay attention to that. So there was some excitement around the newsprint coverage. More than the usual hostility and anxieties about loss of control that customarily drive culture wars and other media panics, the dominant affect here was rather an amused contempt that anyone might think orgasm a proper object for scholarly consideration. This was common currency for most media reports during this period, but we can take as exemplary the moment when a leading radio journalist, in his weekly interview with the Prime Minister, tabled as his most persuasive evidence the abstract from my research proposal, to my mind, the most accurate account of my project that was aired in the media during this time, as if its intricacy made self-evident everything that was preposterous about its having received government funding. Occupying his incomprehension, as if it were an accurate measure of the deficiencies of my project, this journalist nevertheless reinforced something for me in relation to the discursive contours of modern orgasm. It was not simply the hypocrisy of ridiculing anyone investing scholarly time and labour in a subject clearly fascinating enough to magnetise sustained media attention and public interest. More salutary was his presumption of knowingness about orgasm and his extension of that presumption to the Prime Minister and even beyond her to the anonymous mass of his listeners. The broadcast subtext was that there is nothing to be said about orgasm because we know it all already. The original working title for my project, 20th Century Orgasm, was intended as a corrective to the presumption that we know all that can be usefully known about orgasm. As a rubric, 20th Century Orgasm was meant to unsettle the complacent because largely ahistorical sense that in contrast to various earlier understandings of orgasm, many of which have proved inaccurate in light of current medical and scientific knowledges, the 20th century was when orgasm shook off persistent folkloric narratives and emerged as a comprehensively investigated and transparently known phenomenon. Rather than presume that post-Kinsey, post-Height report, post-Graffenberg spot, we know everything there is to know about orgasm, thinking critically about its centrality to the 20th century redefinition of sexuality as a means of self-realisation rooted in pleasure and unconnected to reproduction, makes possible the historicisation of a bodily event all too often explained, or rather explained away, as ahistorical or natural, the allegedly unremarkable effect of biological or evolutionary drives. Through the unkind offices of those whose flaunted knowingness about orgasm functioned in part as a badge of their modernity, I saw now, however, that the rubric of 20th century orgasm simply compounded the problem it meant to address. for it could most easily be interpreted as not only distinguishing between orgasms historical and contemporary, but also securing that distinction by reifying modern orgasm as a single knowable phenomenon, the 20th century kind. Contrarywise, I had intended that the phrase would function as a reminder that orgasm as we moderns encounter it is not a simple thing. According to this logic, 20th century orgasm would operate as a placeholder for a complex constellation of ideas that figures orgasm in diverse, often contradictory ways. In framing modern orgasm as a historical subject, I had thought to short-circuit its invocation as an ahistorical phenomenon, thereby foregrounding its specificity and its distinctiveness, the unique compactions of cultural meaning that have accrued to orgasm, as well as the wide repertory of narratives that have taken orgasm as their figural vehicle across the 20th century. To insist on the discursive ambivalence of orgasm is to resist the common presumption that when it manifests, orgasm is an unambiguous thing in itself, its own process of demystification. Addressing an audience of his peers at the 1991 First International Conference on Orgasm, sexologist John Money could put it this simply. We use the rule of thumb to test that no matter how they name it, those who are not sure if they've had an orgasm almost certainly have not had one. This who feels it knows it school of thought is consistent with one of the most powerful and influential constructions of orgasm in the 20th century, the sexological production of orgasm as a particular type of neurologically complex sensory motor reflex, the exact profile of which continues to be determined and verified by sustained clinical observation. Consider as exemplary in this regard the standardisation and stabilisation of orgasm in Alfred Kinsey's monumental studies, Sexual Behaviour in the Human Male, and its companion volume, Sexual Behaviour in the Human Female, both publishing landmarks for 20th century understandings of sexuality. Defining orgasm in terms of outlet, Kinsey uses its alleged stability in order to quantify sexual practice. Unless it ends in orgasm, sexual activity doesn't count in the literal statistical sense as an event. Noting the difficulty of specifying scientifically between the spheres of the erotic and the non-erotic, between, for example, the socially decorous and the libidinally passionate kiss, Kinsey insists on the material actuality of orgasm, which he describes variously as a distinct and specific phenomenon and elsewhere a concrete unit. For Kinsey, orgasm makes sex countable. His dogged insistence that there is, as he writes, no better unit than orgasm for measuring the incidences and frequencies of sexual activity enables him to suspend moral distinctions between different classes of sexual activity, all of which are even-handedly classified as variations of a basic sexual release. In defining orgasm as a generic and replicable unit of quantification, Kinsey was part of the process whereby orgasm has been specified with increasing precision across the 20th century as an embodied event, temporarily identified as a definite and defined period in the successive stages of the human sexual response, and particularised through such representational technologies as the electroencephalograph, the electrocardiograph, and magnetic resonance imaging. Yet the more orgasm is materialised through these various medical imaging techniques, the less recognisable it seems in relation to its everyday non-laboratory manifestations. Made strange by the very technologies that would apprehend it more fully, orgasm can seem to refuse or slip from under the usual protocols of representation. In suggesting that orgasm resists objectification, resists, that is to say, the intellectual or affective apprehension that might produce it as a demarcated or circumscribed event, I am, of course, participating in an almost equally well-worn discursive tradition that brings orgasm to figuration by staging it as unrepresentable. This problem of unrepresentability might be conceptualised primarily as a technical difficulty, as can be seen in the literary modernist project whose experimental interest in giving form to interiorised subjectivity often takes orgasm as its limit case. The narrowly technical or literal understanding of the difficulty of representing orgasm that literary modernism, like hardcore pornography, addresses, is amplified by a further contingent or strategic sense, as is evident when feminist philosopher Elizabeth Gross meditates on what it might mean to write about orgasm. She writes, "Originally I had planned to write this essay on female sexuality and particularly on female orgasm. After much hope and considerable anguish that I would be unable to evoke the languid pleasures and intense particularities of female orgasm, hardly a project for which the discipline of philosophy, or for that matter psychoanalysis, could provide adequate theoretical training, I abandoned this idea, partly because it seemed to me to be a project involving great disloyalty, speaking the philosophically unsayable, spilling the beans on a vast historical secret, one about which many men and some women have developed prurient interests, and partly because I realised that at the very most, what I write could be read largely as autobiography, as the true confessions of my own experience, and have little more than anecdotal value. I could have no guarantees that my descriptions or analyses would have relevance to other women." So I'm interested in that long quote because here, with some optimism and more than a little trepidation, Gross describes the prospect of writing an essay on female orgasm. Although it gives her pause, it's not finally the literal difficulty of specifying and defining the essential characteristics of female orgasm that make her beg off her original plan. Although she considers she doesn't have the formal training for it, she remains confident that the apparently leisured rhythms of female orgasm and its peculiar distinctiveness might nevertheless be disciplined into description. It is rather for two other reasons, no less connected to the problem of representation that female orgasm constitutes, that Gross abandons her ideas and turns her critical attention elsewhere. What stops the feminist philosopher in her traces is not finally a technical problem caused by the difficulty of representing orgasm, but an ethical one, attentive to the dilemmas attendant on such representation. First, Gross reflects that it is the historical status of female orgasm as unrepresentable, at least within certain disciplinary traditions, that means any attempt to bring it to representation collaborates with those cultural forces bent on making it yield its secret truth, forces oddly unspecified, yet evident in the prurient interests of many men and some women. According to a tactically tautological logic, by dint of being philosophically unsayable, female orgasm must remain unrepresented. Second, she reasons that any account she might give of female orgasm risks being received as autobiographically disclosing, a judgment she appears to second when she allows that other women may find nothing apposite in her account. Here, the intense particularities of female orgasm have contracted so tightly that they can suffer no generalisation whatsoever, being applicable only to the single individual who experiences them, and therefore of little relevance to any other. Even though, in the context in which Gross uses them, these two explanations are self-reinforcing, the two reasons she offers for her critical shift subscribe to quite different understandings of orgasm, both in prominent 20th century circulation. The distinction can be grasped more securely when it's understood that the first explanation hinges on disloyalty and the second on irrelevance. In arguing that her representation of female orgasm would constitute an act of gender treachery, Gross represents orgasm as a shared experience that is communal insofar as it binds her impersonally to the imaginary population constituted by her gender. But in arguing that it would be inconsequential, she represents it as a highly particularising and distinctive event experienced as idiosyncratic, almost to the point of alienation. So if 20th century orgasm is representable and unrepresentable, It is also and at once personal and impersonal. And yet these are only a couple of the many contradictions that structure what orgasm can mean in the 20th century. 20th century orgasm is also innate and acquired, voluntary and involuntary, mechanistic and psychological, literal and figurative, trivial and precious, social and asocial, modern and postmodern, liberative and regulatory, an index for autonomy and self-actualization, as well as for interpersonal and communal attachment, the epitome and the extinction of erotic pleasure, indifferent and intrinsic to taxonomic categories of sexual difference and sexual orientation. These oppositions aren't entirely specific to orgasm, nor without precedent. They draw their contradictory charge from the historic processes whereby sexuality has come to constitute a framework of intelligibility for sex. Noting the ways in which something legitimately called sex or sexuality is all over the experiential and conceptual map, Eve Kosofsky-Sedgwick argues that sex, sexuality, does tend to represent the full spectrum of positions between the most intimate and the most social, the most predetermined and the most aleatory, the most physically rooted and the most symbolically infused, the most autonomous and the most relational traits of being. Orgasm's structuring contradictions, then, are evidence of their intrinsic intimacy with the epistemological contours of modern sexuality. As such, they can't be explained away, nor even decisively arbitrated. Rather than resolve orgasm's semantic ambiguities, my project is to use its ambivalent profile to revisit issues of abiding interest for scholars of sexuality, to approach familiar questions sideways. This tactic involves seeing past the already known object or event of orgasm in order to recognise the capacity of its lateral energies to reorganise axiomatically or even complacently held knowledges about not only sex, sexual orientation and sexual difference, but also the social contract, democracy, ethics, capitalism, modernity, affect and history, to name some of the big ticket concepts that get a skewed attention in my book project. Thinking about orgasm in these terms as something that can't contain itself, that articulates itself to scenes it seems initially to have no business with, has often worked in me a welcome everyday derangement. The longer I stuck with it as an idea, and orgasm's talent for spilling beyond its apparently proper confines, coupled with the widely documented difficulties in apprehending it, even at the moment of its literal specification or definition, meant the lengthy period of sticking with sometimes felt less tenaciously, more traumatically like being stuck, the more it seemed to me that orgasm might be one of our richer cultural repositories for thinking queerly. That is, for thinking about sex unindentured to sexuality and about sexuality beyond disciplinary pragmatics. Less an organising than a disorganising principle, orgasm as a critical term is taken up but not exhausted by questions of politics and pleasure, practice and subjectivity, agency and ethics. Far from producing a cultural history of orgasm in the 20th century, I'm interested in the ways in which 20th century orgasm can't be persuaded to pull itself together in a single authorising narrative. The difficulty of stabilising orgasm sufficiently to get a scholarly bead on it, without losing a feel for the ephemeral multivalence that makes it such a critically productive figure in the first place, meant there was a stretch of time during which I feared that, contrary to the vast and ever-expanding catalogue of quasi-anthropological things about which the opposite is readily claimed, orgasm might not be good to think with. It is, however, the inchoate discursive energies of orgasm, some of which I've tried to sketch here, that guarantee its vitality as a critical term. Although in use in sexological and related literatures, Orgasmology is not a word officially recognised in dictionaries. As a term, then, it's intended to capitalise on the maverick energies of orgasm's various double binds. The Scrabble board query that orgasmology elicits, is that a word, suggests something of its implausibility, the way the term is hardly able to hold itself together, threatening to come apart at the seam where unschooled orgasm tries to stitch itself up with learned ology. The appeal of orgasmology as a title rests in the term's capacity to lay simultaneous claim to the scholarly and the ironic, the suffix at once conferring legitimacy on orgasm as the basis for a coherent field of study and mocking the pretension to any such legitimation. If orgasmology suggests that a field of knowledge might properly cohere about orgasm as a scholarly object, it also suggests that such a field is more a fantasy formation than a disciplinary one. Nevertheless, the highly charged figure of 20th century orgasm might prove useful for contemporary sexuality studies. The efficacy of orgasm as a conceptual term is not due to some intrinsic quality of orgasm itself. I'm not suggesting, for instance, that orgasm enjoys any privileged relation to sexuality, but rather to the way in which it falls across or slips between the categories of analysis more commonly used to investigate sexuality in lesbian, gay, bisexual, transgender, queer, and feminist studies. As a term, orgasm lets us take a break from the critical traditions and conceptual paradigms that have patterned our understanding of sexuality. If I pursue orgasm as my organising principle, it's not because I think a grand interventionist narrative might be founded in its name. Rather, my hunch about its conceptual efficacy derives from its very beside-the-pointness, the fact that orgasm is mostly regarded as tangential to the major structuring rubrics of sexuality studies. Again, the elasticated semantic reach of orgasmology proves useful. For even as it attests to the impossibility of orgasm constituting a field of knowledge in the traditional disciplinary sense, orgasmology keeps in circulation the valuable idea that orgasm, when considered as the focus for critical inquiry, might productively ground scholarship insofar as it has the capacity to reorder axiomatic knowledges, to make a different sense of the schematic systems via which sexuality is defined and investigated. Since orgasm is neither an identity, nor even in the strict and strictly modern sense in which that term is customarily formulated, an act, a consideration of 20th century orgasm as a resolutely historical formation holds open for critical engagement an interpretive space between sexual identity and sexual act, the coordinates that have significantly structured the regulation of modern sexuality and consequently much of sexuality studies to date. Indentured to no particular sexual formation or behaviour, orgasm overrides, even as it makes increasingly fine distinctions between, more stable and authoritative categories of sexual classification. Central to, and yet not definitive of, the range of practices and identities that knit up sexuality as it has come to be known, the allegedly common language of orgasm marks a productive fault line for everyday understandings of the body and sexual desire, giving rise to a different framework for thinking historically about sexual subjectivity and practice in the 20th century and no doubt beyond.
Get the questions on the mic, or
I mean, in principle, well, no,
we just have to ask people to yell because of the taping. So I will moderate the session. We have 37 minutes. Questions, performances. Yeah, hey Jane.
So you began it's more the frame of the beginning by basically saying queer theory dismisses the orgasm, calls it banal, as it were. That's the provocation. Which is fine, except the thing that I've been thinking about is that you exemplified and basically represented queer theory with Deleuze and Foucault, neither of whom I actually think of when I think of, you know, who are the major queer theorists. I don't necessarily even think of them as queer theorists. So it feels like it's a bit of a setup to say, those were, you set that up, because then you went on to say, well, then there's also Baudrillard and Heath as, you know, other kind of progressive intellectuals. But you began by saying, this is the queer theory dismissal of orgasm, and then you locate it with two people who are certainly related to queer theory, influences on queer theory, et cetera, but who are not actually queer theorists. So I'm wondering about how that works and why you set it up that way.
Right. I wouldn't say that I think of Deleuze or Foucault as queer theorists, although I think that their respective theories very much are foundational platforms for the growth of queer theory kind of as we read it today. So partly because this is sort of drawn from an introduction to a wider project, I guess what, you know, naturally you don't get to hear are the sort of chapters when I would go in and read specifically different queer theoretical takes on sexual agency and, political sort of transformation. So what I'm interested in is thinking about why certain orders of sex or certain kinds of sexual agency, certain sexual practices, certain sexual, you know, venues even, in queer theoretical parameters can be represented as more progressive, more allied with political use value than a set of other terms, one of which is prominently orgasm. So, you know, for example, well, actually, I've already published this as a journal article, but a chapter on fake orgasm tries to think through a sort of a indexically feminine heterosexual practice as perhaps embodying a different order of political agency and engagement than, say, the kind of typical public sex practices that queer theory sort of extols as its sort of primary sort of practice. So for me, the interest there is, first and foremost, I think partly because, you know, obviously I spent a few years thinking about orgasm, it's sort of strikingly interesting how little room there is in a queer theoretical parameter for thinking that orgasm would have anything to tell us, to thinking that it would have anything to say, and that it wouldn't be immediately fed back into the most sort of reprehensible conservatisms we could imagine. And so to make that visible, because I don't think queer theory anywhere literally says that, I don't think, you know, it's not like a slogan, I think it is just intrinsic to a whole bunch of kind of critical thinking that I sort of tease out in the larger manuscript. It's then interesting to me to think, well, what if we actually, inside a queer theoretical purview, took orgasm kind of seriously? And it turns out it makes a lot of disruptive mess, which is, I think, you know, quite a good thing.
So I have a question that touches on a comment that you made about orgasm, and it sort of rang some bells for me with the Edelman's essay. Is the rectum brave? And so I wanted to ask, Versani.
Lee Edelman wishes.
Yeah. So I was just going to ask about the relationship between that essay and your project, because it seems to sort of embrace the non-representable aspect of orgasm, but still use it to like get some epistemological gain.
Is that your characterization of the Bersani essay?
Yeah, because he sort of embraces the shattering aspect, right? And we all kind of implicitly associate this with the, you know, with orgasm. But he sidesteps having to pin that connection together. And it seems like you're sort of taking a similar interest in that disjuncture.
Yeah, that's an interesting question. Is the rectum a grave has, you know, not surprisingly, been a really important essay for me thinking through some of these conceptualizations. I guess on the one hand, it's pretty clear that subsequently Bassani has stepped a long way away from any kind of literalising notion that the self-shattering that he describes in that essay would be in any way connected to orgasm, let alone sexual practice. Nevertheless, people, myself included, can say all sorts of retrospective things about, you know, the cleverer things we wish we had said when we wrote essays some while ago. Going back to that essay, what really interests me about it is, I guess for us now mostly, that essay is read as either the origin or a very important contributor to a kind of queer antisocial sort of thesis position. And while I don't dispute that, that kind of large sort of formulaic tidying up, you know, the sort of historical retrospection that's necessary to sort of tell that story, kind of obscures the extent to which Bassani really thinks very hard about sex in that essay. In fact, he says a number of times in that essay, he urges us as readers to think about the literal practices of sex. And he describes a few, you know, as he goes along, which only makes it all the more telling that actually the kind of, I think now, the majority critical reception of that essay reads it as if sex were a very intensely saturated metaphor for something else. So what I'm interested in going back to that essay is to really look at those few passages where he describes particular kinds of sex acts, associating them also with a kind of sexual self-abandonment. And so I guess I'm thinking, even though perhaps he distances himself from that project, it's still one of the important texts for my project because it's one of the really early queer theoretical attempts to think about sex and its kind of material practices and how, obviously, for Bassani, that may or may not attach to a kind of political project. Again, I think that essay is read most commonly as a decisive denunciation that there will be any necessary relation between sex and the political, and I think that is a true and accurate reading of the essay. And yet, Bassani says at a number of points in that essay, he kind of goes, circles back and sort of almost wistfully kind of says, you know, that difficult to define relationship between the erotic and the political, or that hard to pin down moment. So there's something in that essay that I think maybe sort of, I'm now thinking of a sort of roadkill. It's been a bit sort of flattened out by so many successive drive-bys, but there's sort of something in there that still remains quite vital for some of the thinking that I'm doing here.
This points to I guess, the remainder of the project, since the introduction seems to be clearing the air of the discourse around the orgasm. But I guess my question is, in some ways, like, the orgasm as a subject unifies multiple different types of events and different types of embodiments, and I was wondering how you work through this multiplicity of different types of bodily pleasures that lead to different types of orgasms.
Well, most things that we take as our scholarly objects do risk something of the kind of homogenization that you're describing. I think that's kind of probably an inevitable part of what it means to, you know, take something as your object, and, you know, possibly Robin standing beside me would have a lot more to say on that subject. I haven't really tried to say too much about different forms of orgasm, although I realise I do have a chapter on fake orgasm, as I've mentioned, and I do have another chapter on simultaneous orgasm. But for me, the thing is not so much about the types of orgasm that they are as what kinds of critical theoretical engagement does orgasm enable? So it's not at all a sort of a sociological or even a phenomenological project. Its points of purchase really are sort of critical theoretical. So, for example, I don't really have a great deal to say about orgasm as it's sort of experienced, or as it might be, say, demographically tabulated as a sort of a practice or an experience. I'm more thinking about what kind of work does it get asked to do, critically speaking, and if we refuse certain of its kind of figurations, what different kind of critical purposes can we put it to?
Thank you for a great talk. hear you talk a little bit about how you responded to that public uproar. And also, I'm completely in awe that you're going to go where Liz Gross has feared to tread. And I'd actually love a little more on sort of how you're responding to some of the questions that she raises and that quote that you gave of hers. I mean, I know you just said you might not speak so much to the experiential, but then what's also at stake in not doing that?
To sort of take that second bit first, I guess I do a lot of that work because I'm interested in thinking about the sort of representational profile of orgasm sort of as a 20th century sort of phenomenon. but I think there's quite a bit in that presentation that gives you some indication of the kind of coloration of that discussion, thinking about what its sort of structuring contradictions are, for example. In relation to the sort of the first point, don't know that this is sort of like such a great professional example, but the coverage was so sort of silly that I just decided to simply say nothing because the conversation was happening at such a uninformed and sort of basically dim-witted kind of level that I realised that anything that I would offer up by way of a soundbite would sort of get slotted into a very small sort of space, and so I just regularly for 3 weeks, no commented, until it got to the point where the sort of the publicity office at my university, you know, via the vice chancellor called me to say, we think if you just said something, they might, you know, shut up. And I said, well, I have said something. There's the, you know, abstract for my project. And then they sort of like sent a little sort of PR person along to my office to help me write that in a kind of like friendly, accessible way. And I sort of tried to have a bit of a go at that with her. And then when I realised, you know, she now sounded like cosmopolitan, I said, no, I wouldn't do it. That wasn't what my project was. My project really was this one. And if it didn't seem, you know, accessible to a certain kind of tabloid presentation, well, that kind of suited me.
Thanks very much for your talk. I have got two questions. The first question is about place concerned with PCs, and the second one is about representation. The first one, about disease, I was thinking about gay male sexuality and gay male orgasm, and thinking about this already makes me feel intellectually horny. my question is there a role for disease in your account of orgasmology? I mean, I was thinking about in the 1980s, 1990s, you know, gay male sexuality and was haunted by the HIV and AIDS epidemic, right? So when I think about, you know, gay male orgasm or gay male sexuality, you know, I feel this is the pleasure that, you know, that goes up, right? But it was slowed down by the AIDS epidemic, right? I mean, the kind of memory of that and the idea of death, right? Loss and mourning and melancholia, right? So that's the first question.
Maybe I'll give you my first answer because remember, I haven't slept for a very long time. Yes. And if you go on to your second question, I'm almost certain to forget. Like, literally in my project, there's not a great deal about orgasm and disease, but that's probably due to a whole lot of, individual decisions and kind of personal sort of scholarly preferences that I have for the sort of things I write. I agree with you that within the kind of conceptual sort of parameters that I'm working in, it would be very feasible and interesting to think about AIDS, HIV, etc. I guess we'd want to say something about the difference between orgasm maybe as a kind of embodied pleasurable response versus sort of ejaculation as a maybe sort of more medical health education event. But there are people who've worked interestingly on work in that area. Murat Ademir's book called maybe Images of Bliss, I think, which came out a couple of years ago, is a great sort of critical theoretical reading of male ejaculation through a whole range of literary theoretical sources and pornographic ones. And of course, I think also Tim Dean's latest book also has some smart stuff to say about orgasm, ejaculation, and in relation to, you know, particular kind of sexual practices, all of which seems kind of, you know, neighbourly and proximate to my project, although literally in the voice that I give it, that doesn't take much sort of profile.
The second question is about representation. Right, you said that orgasm is not representable, right? I was thinking if there's any way to get out of that, right? I was thinking about Jack LaCombe's idea of the real, the symbolic, and the imaginary, right? The real is something that cannot be represented, right? It is beyond symbolic representation. So I was thinking maybe the orgasm you're talking about is the kind of Lacanian, the real, with capital R, right? And then maybe, so the question is, what exactly is the symbolic and what exactly is the imaginary, right? And perhaps the symbolic is a text that has nothing to do with sex or orgasm, but somehow the kind of sexual unconscious of it, right, is the orgasm you're talking about. And it, the mediation between the latent, the manifest layer and the latent layer, which is the Lacanian real or the orgasm, has to be mediated by the imaginary, right? So maybe that's a suggestion to get out of that.
Right. Gosh. Some cures for jet lag are better than others. I'm not sure that I'm going to be sort of adequate to a response about, you know, a Lacanian kind of figuration of orgasm, but with a capital R or any other capitals, in fact. I think, though, that I would sort of be a bit resistant to the idea that I'm describing some situation we might like to get out of. I think I'm... The point I'm making really is not that orgasm is unrepresentable. I'm trying to draw attention to the sort of thick ways in which it's represented at historically similar moments as both highly representable and unrepresentable, and ask what does that mean for the cultural configuration of orgasm.
Yeah, so a couple of questions. The first one is to go back to the Foucault quote on bodies and pleasures.
Just
speak
up a little bit.
You just try. I was wondering how you actually distinguish your conceptualization of orgasm from what Foucault calls bodies and pleasures. As I understand your views of the quote, what Foucault perhaps means is that orgasm is a kind of teleological process, or at least some end-oriented process with finality in the Aristotelian sense. So whether you want to think about, say, orgasm as death in John Donne's poetry, or what we call coming, there is some kind of final process. Whereas as far as I gather what Foucault says, bodies and pleasures have no finality in that sense. So does your notion of orgasm imply some kind of process that has no end? And if so, how does it imply process? The second question, I guess...
Can I make the same rules apply to you?
She's already begged for one at a time.
Okay, no, I don't really have... Like, I'm not sort of barracking for my version of orgasm here. You know, it's not... You know, there's Foucault's version and Annamarie Jagos' version is like this. And, you know, I would be, you know, reckless in the extreme to suggest that I have a version of orgasm that is continuous without end. I think that would be, you know, a tough one to claim from a podium. The point really is that I'm not trying to instantiate a kind of a political schema in the name of a figure of orgasm. I'm not speaking for it in a particular kind of way. I'm not advocating for it. I'm not taking it as the name for a different sort of critical school of thought. I'm just trying to think through what the consequences are of certain kinds of critical theoretical formation for it. I think your characterization of, you know, what Foucault may or may not think of orgasm is more the Deleuzian model. I think Foucault's resistance to orgasm is specifically, and hence the reason it doesn't fall into his kind of fairly underspecified regime of bodies and pleasures, is I think around the different relationships those two sorts of fields have to regulatory processes of normalisation. Not that it's without end, but that orgasm has been one of the prime sort of 20th century sites where medical knowledge has kind of fastened onto the human body in certain sorts of ways.
So then the second question is, when you responded to the question about different types of orgasm, you specifically said you didn't want to specify what different experiences or types of orgasm. Nevertheless, orgasm does some work for you. The question is, does it do some work because it's passively limited or framed by a certain horizon? For instance, this notion of a fake orgasm. Derrida Spurs, he wrote about fake orgasm or women's ability to fake or simulate orgasm as something that undoes the question of being in the Heideggerian sense. But that's really because it's determined within a very specific horizon that's left tacit. So I'm wondering what exactly is the horizon for you under which orgasm can be the kind of world it has?
Well, I think that horizon for me is queer theory. So it has a very practical, present tense scholarly investment in thinking about the queer theoretical project and its representation of sex, sexual agency, and politics. So, which is maybe why there's a bit of a disruption or a gap between the opening sort of paragraphs of this, you know, what will in fact be the introduction, is also part of my attempt to prevent a project on orgasm being instantly read as nothing to do with queer theory. I felt like I needed to make a very big claim right up front to establish those coordinates, because the most common kind of reception from people thinking they know what I'm interested in talking about understand that I would be sort of advocating from a generally feminist perspective that, you know, ladies should have more orgasms, you know, something sort of like that. So really, I don't have a kind of a philosophical horizon. It's really a quite sort of practical one in terms of thinking about, you know, a queer theoretical project I've been thinking about for some years.
I found myself thinking about the time of sex, and I was curious if your thoughts had taken you there. And a few of where my thoughts went were, like, it would make juicier Heidegger's ecstatic temporality. Another thought was about Kairos versus Chronos and the kairotic moment being maybe the orgasmic moment that disappears, so that mainly you have pre- and post-orgasmic time as a temporality. And I was just wondering if the temporality of it, is that something that, have your thoughts taken you there? And
Sort of sketchily and sustainedly in different sort of sections of the project. So part of this introduction also maps some of those temporal framings that you were suggesting there. Different critical perspectives framing orgasm as something, you know, very precisely kind of timed, and others insisting that, you know, orgasm is kind of without time in some sort of important way. You know, Dominic Pettman arguing that there's no present tense for orgasm, only, you know, past and future. The chapter on simultaneous orgasm looks at a kind of a practice that really emerges in the very early 20th century as a kind of marital ideal, and then I try to read that ideal against the what I think of as the conflicted sort of temporalities of modernity and how they may or may not shape our notions of heteronormativity. So the synchronicity of simultaneous orgasm seems to me important inside that broader temporal understanding of modernity. So that would be sort of like a chapter which would be very interested in temporality, whereas others, you know, would be uninterested at all, you know, not have much interest at all.
I would like to hear to what extent is your notion of orgasm like Foucault's way of talking about sex. The Foucauldian way would be to denormalize sex and to say that all we have are just sexual practices. But I'm not sure that I'm hearing the same thing in your project. Are you saying that to hell with the notion of orgasm, from now on we should just look at orgasmic practices? Or are you saying something quite different? In other words, I'm interested in whether you are in fact retaining the essence of orgasm in this project. Are you saying that there is such a thing as orgasm?
Right, okay, I was going to ask you from what is the essence of orgasm? I was seeing a quick way to get my conclusion drafted. I'm certainly not saying there is no such thing as orgasm. Neither am I sort of suggesting that there is some, you know, uber orgasm that is kind of more orgasmic than others. I guess I'm sounding a little repetitive, I know, but it's very important to me that I not be heard to be making some kind of claim or stake on the basis of orgasm. You know, like, here's yet another figure around which we can rally differently than the last figure we rallied differently around. I'm really more interested in thinking about orgasm as an available figure that's been kind of culturally represented and even experienced in a whole range of kind of ways, and trying to say through the thick sort of texture of those sometimes contradictory representations and sort of experiences, what kind of work does it do? And if we think about orgasm and make it central to our critical theorising, how does it require us to think against some of the more axiomatic figurings of sexuality? I believe there may be.
There definitely may be. Carla.
Yeah, I'm going to try out how I've always read that Elizabeth Gross passage, which appears in Animal Sex, I believe. You tell me if you think that's, I'm on the right track there or not. I always read it together with her essay in the volume Robin edited, Who Can Speak, where she talks about one of the reasons for not developing discourse on female sexuality is precisely because it would then make it available for Foucauldian disciplinarization. And she's interested in, and I always thought this was a really interesting thing to say, a kind of hidden something so as not to make it capturable. And I always understood her comment about female orgasm in animal sex to kind of be along those lines. This is why, the first part as opposed to the second part. The second part I thought was actually interesting theorization about female orgasm. And in some ways she goes on without any longer mentioning orgasm to theorize what might be called an ungeneralizable particularity of something like orgasm, and I'm thinking mostly about the scene of the praying mantis biting off the guy praying mantis's head while he's ejaculating, or in order to produce more intense ejaculation, right? And I'm thinking that at least that first part of what she said is a little bit like what you're doing in your project. In other words, you're not making available more information that could be organized and represented. Or it sounds as though you're keeping orgasm as a particularly elusive figure that you want to focus on, but not necessarily attribute content to.
Yeah, I'm just trying to think whether that is a good description of the project, which is maybe a bit of a big thing to try and sort of just think about like that. It's not that I'm trying to maintain it as a figure of unrepresentability. I think it has all sorts of manifest content. It's just that it has lots of different kind of content in different sort of circumstances. And so what sort of drew me to that sort of particular passage the passage of Liz's, I mean, is that it seems that that passage is not aware that it is actually organised around a fundamentally contradictory understanding of orgasm, and that's what interests me about it. She puts both of those forward successively as if to say, look, here was one reason and here's another reason, you know, and hence I decided to write this other essay. But what interests me about it is, hey, but one reason was that, you know, you'd let the cat out of the bag, sort of, so to speak, you know, making something available for, you know, disciplinary kind of connection. And the other one is that, you know, it's all entirely insular and there is no kind of commonality of experience or reference. And again, that seemed like a really interesting moment to me where, even though the essay is actually interested in getting somewhere else, that moment seemed like quite a good illustration of the way in which quite contradictory paradigms for thinking about orgasm coexist. And that's what I'm trying to do in the introduction, is really to build up a very sort of thick picture of what all those different contradictions are and whether it's sort of possible or desirable to sort of think them in one frame and say, what does that kind of tell us? And you know, I mean, I'm not meaning that it will tell us something sort of major or mystical. It really tells us that some of our critical apparatuses for thinking about sex and sexuality are very partial, and that incline us in certain kinds of directions and not in others. And I try to use orgasm as a bit of a corrective for thinking about that.
Thank you for your talk. How come everyone in New Zealand freaked out? Why such resistance? I've also kind of felt really bad for the philosophers who said in the beginning. Why such resistance on both sides to thinking about orgasms and something that's such, at the very least, pretty fun?
Well, I think, you know, all my sort of scholarly work has been either identifiably lesbian, gay, or queer theory, or, as you know, Robin says, and I don't protest at all, you know, queer lesbian kind of work. So, oh, lesbian, queer. Look, we're already fighting. We're already fighting. So it's not as if I am accustomed to, you know, the public reception of my work being kind of august and, you know, kind of hallowed. But nevertheless, orgasm did seem to sort of strike the kind of public reception as a sort of a new low, that it's, you know, surely it can't be possible that anyone would have an interest in this sort of very ridiculous sort of topic. And so, again, you know, I mean, really what that made me think about was the kind of gaps between, you know, an incessant sort of popular mediatisation of orgasm, particularly female orgasm, of which, you know, you can sort of, there's a lot of sort of popular kind of discourse on that topic, but the idea that it was sort of too ludicrous for a, you know, for a kind of a competitive, you know, government grant, I think is sort of, you know, fairly typical of what some kinds of, you know, sexuality studies scholars, you know, are up against when they're trying to compete for funds which are usually indexed to notions of, say, public good and so forth, and where it's very hard sometimes to illustrate what the, you know, my you know, valiant people who were speaking to the press during this period and trying to defend me in my silence were saying things like, it's very important that, you know, relationships, you know, are stable and that, you know, orgasm is, you know, so it was like, you know, that was the attempt to make it sort of recognisable as a public good, you know.
Talk about the public good.
So this sort of goes back to the first question where you addressed how you were sort of setting up your project as an intervention in queer theory and its overlooking of sex. And then you alluded a little bit to, you didn't want it to be read in terms of just like advocating like that ladies need to have more orgasms. And I was kind of wondering if you could elaborate a little bit, like what difference it makes to you for this project and orgasms as, you know, an object of inquiry to be read within a feminist theory sort of context or project versus a queer theory project. And I'm really thinking about this just in terms of the, you know, feminism's queer theory article and, you know, the various distinctions between the two and what difference they make and you know, what distinctions we want to uphold and not uphold at certain times. And I just feel like this project really raises a lot of questions about, you know, that come up in that article.
Yeah, that's a good question.
I'm sure you've thought through it a lot, so I'm curious.
I'm glad that you've read, you know, feminism's queer theory, because that kind of gives me a bit of a pass as being someone who I think is not, you know, barracking for queer theory at the expense of feminist theory. I guess what I was meaning to sort of indicate there was that in working on orgasm, you become extremely recognisable and visible inside certain forms of feminist theorising. That seems to be the work that people expect you will do in relation to orgasm. But I realised, actually, I had little or limited interest in thinking about it only inside that template. I wanted actually to think about it inside a template that is entirely feminist, but which is also putting pressure on a queer theoretical one. Whereas I realised if I didn't emphasise that queer theoretical one, it would be very easy to overread a not read a project on orgasm, because it would be seen to take a different kind of constituency. So, you know, for example, the chapter on fake orgasm is again an attempt to think a feminist theoretical coordinate against a queer theoretical one, and find, very similarly to feminism's queer theory, find what is the shared ground for those two projects, and how does each one kind of amplify the other, potentially, if not always in practice.
Kind of what I was going to ask, how you're engaged with the contradiction, really, in some ways, between early U.S. radical feminist theory that reclaimed the plural orgasm and all of that, and really highlighted the politicization, historically, of the female orgasm against this queer theory.
And again, that, you know, that particular kind of moment doesn't make much impact in this project, although, you know, Jane Gearhart's book, of course, you know, reads that entire historical moment through the, you know, through the figure of orgasm. She asks, you know, what did orgasm do, and what work did it do for a sort of second wave feminism? So it's not that that's kind of uninteresting. In part, it's that work has actually been done quite comprehensively. But it also, it takes us to a particular known kind of place. And I'm more interested in seeing that as one node of a kind of a broader sort of network of interrogation that maybe connects that discussion up to other things, rather than seeing that is the kind of conclusion, that is the kind of main point, that it's a project about, you know, female sexual agency and a right to, you know, erotic autonomy, none of which I, you know, am against in any kind of way, but that's not the full kind of force of the project.
So against her object of study, we are actually going to end on time. And thank you very much.
Thank you.
Produced by Duke University, online at duke.edu.